Welcome to the 100th episode of The Profile. Didn't think we'd ever get here, but here we are. And tonight, we have the most wonderful special guest you could ever imagine, someone totally dear to my heart. Please welcome Mr. Gary Dunn. How are you, guys?
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you for coming in. Really appreciate it. So,
You stupid boy.
What?
What are you doing? You cannot interview yourself. Get out of the chair. Give me the file. Get your ass over there. Right, you stupid boy. Welcome to The Profile. My name is Alan Simpson, and this is episode 100. And this week I interview the man himself, the compere, Gary Dunn.
How are you?
I'm good, mate.
It feels strange sitting in this chair.
Not as strange as me sitting in this chair, buddy, but I'll see if I can make you sound, feel as strange as you can throughout the night.
Yep.
Right, where do we start? Now, I think the first question you normally come out with is, where were you born?
I was born in a place called Hilton Castle in Sunderland, in Northern England. They were called Mackhams, and I ended up becoming a Toon fan. So I defected to the other side of the town called Newcastle. So I'm still there. So
you call yourself a Geordie, is that right?
I am. We are, man. Yeah.
And instruments, what do you play?
I play guitar. I can play piano. I can play bass. I can play drums.
I know you can sing.
Singing.
No, you can sing. I've actually heard you sing. I know you're very good at Brown Eyed Girl. I've heard that at the casino.
Oh, don't you just love that?
Yeah, it's one of my favourites. And just recently, I did hear Lovers in the Air. And didn't the crowd sing along with you? Eh? Okay, so we've done that. Now, Gaz, at what point in your life did that light bulb just go off and go, ka-ching, I want to play music? When was it?
This may sound strange to you.
Nothing you say sounds strange to me.
I was born in 1960. In 1963, a song called Needles and Pins was released in April.
The Searchers.
And my mum took me on a double-decker bus to buy the single, the 45, and came home, and I used to get the coat hanger and pretend I was playing guitar, and I used to call it a digitar.
Digitar.
Because I didn't know how to speak properly.
This is in the UK?
Yeah. In Newcastle, and I think from that time, 1964, Hard Day's Night came out, and I was just into guitar.
Rock and roll.
If I go back in my memories, that's when I wanted to. That's when the light bulb moment went off for me. Although it wasn't until a later time at school that...
when you noticed girls, it really came to fruition then, didn't it?
Well, to be honest with you, I was in a place called Wyala in South Australia.
Lots of people from Wyala.
Yes. I'll just digress, because from England in 65, we went to Canada, immigrated to Canada. It was a time of segregation. So the first day at school in Canada, there was a white line in the middle of the lunch room, and the Indigenous Indians were on one side of the white line and us whiteys were on the other. And I didn't know anything about segregation. So... I traded some lunch with some Indian guy right on the white line, and I got beaten up by all the white kids. So we then moved back to England.
Did you get to smoke the peace pipe later?
No, I smoked the peace pipe much later
ever
in life.
That's where you got it from.
Came back to England in 69, and my parents then immigrated to Australia, lived in Brisbane, and we went to Wyala, whereas the next part of where I realised I was going to be a musician. And it was really this bass player in the school band broke his leg, couldn't play. I was a guitar player, and they asked me if I could play bass. I was a really small kid, skinny,
puny.
No girls used to talk to me, really. And then all of a sudden I played in the school band, the school social, one night, and I had a queue of girls lined up the next day when I came back
that
to school.
1969?
That was 1972, actually.
72. Well, yeah. So when did Coronation Street first start?
Coronation Street started Oh, God, I think 1960 or something.
Oh, was it? Okay. No, something. I just wanted to get that out of the way and done with because okay. I don't want to keep bringing it up.
No, well, you probably will.
But. Every episode we get it. What are we up to? Now, okay, well, something here. That, what was your first concert you went to?
First concert I went to was, I think it was Frank Zappa and the Mothers at the Wacker in, I think, 73, something like that, where he said, he came on the stage and he said, something like, first there was man, then there was, whoa, man.
All right.
And that's when I thought, wow, that's cool. What I'm looking at.
Whoa, man. And while we're on the thing, what was the last concert you went to?
Last concert I went to was...
Of any merit, you know what I mean? The big one, good one.
The last good one was probably, God, I can't even remember.
What, you don't go out much or what?
No, I don't, actually. It was Roger Waters.
Roger Waters. Memorable for you.
Anyway,
so had a big impact on that night.
No, it was.
Yeah, the Peace Pipe must have been going that night.
I didn't realise you were going to ask me that question.
Well, okay. Now, okay, bands. I've got my notes here. No producer for me, by the way. I could do this probably without
Where's
a producer.
Where's the producer gone?
Yeah,
that's what I mean. He's there.
He's good, the producer. Oh, his first band, you were age 14. Do you remember anything about it?
Well, there's a guy called Wolfgang Kohler. I can't remember the name of the band, but he used to pick me up in his combi van. I lived in Balga. It was the first place I lived in. Went to Balga High School, obviously. Hank Langdon, Paul McCarthy, like heaps of different guys. Brentley Carnes.
You weren't one of those skinheads hanging around Girraween Balga, were you, back in the day?
I was skinhead, rocker. I was all sorts of stuff. Yeah. But Wolfgang used to pick me up. We used to play at the Raffles and the Eden Hill Tavern. My mum used to say, make sure you get him home by 11 o'clock. Mm. You know, he was only 14 or something. Yeah. So, yeah.
And then that was, what year would that be?
That was about 74. I was about 14, 75. And then Angelo Spadero asked me to join a band called Passport.
Mm-hmm.
And I, for the life of me, can't remember the other members in the band. But, yeah.
Can't remember one.
Yeah. Well, Angelo. I can remember Angelo.
Yeah.
And
the drummer?
We played at the Orient and around there. And, no, I don't remember the drummer. The drummers weren't important to me at that time.
No, I guess you wouldn't remember too many drummers.
Yeah. I was more interested in girls.
And then after that, you didn't do that. You were working. You had to get a day job. Is that right?
Yeah, so I started working at Bones. I met a guy called Alan Simpson.
Yeah, yeah.
Who was in the white goods department down on the bottom floor. And Mouth I was and in off. The third floor running trolleys, mm-hmm. and I remember coming to one Alan Simpson and saying, gee, I'd love to work here, and he went,
you've got to be good to get here, buddy.
Excuse me.
Go back to your trolley.
And then I went to David Jones in the ladies' shoe department, which was very exciting, actually, and to be honest with you, but that was across the road from Musgroves, because Musgroves had burnt down in Murray Street.
Mm-hmm.
They had a big fire, and they went to Hay Street, opposite David Jones. So I used to, every lunch hour, go and see a guy called Ernie Mackey.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to follow him around the shop for an hour and hassle him for a job. And after 2 weeks of that, he said, look, if you stop hassling me,
you
can start next week. So that was, I always felt I needed a job. So I started working in a music shop, Musgroves. And that progressed to a place called Australis Instruments.
Right.
I was a representative for WA. And I did that till 1979. And then got back into music because I wasn't pulling many chicks.
Right, and then you get into a big chick-pulling band, The Mechanics. Weren't they a punk band?
Yes.
Aggressive.
Yes.
Mm. Yeah. Lots of chicks would have gone to that. There'd be more blokes going to that, just headbutting each other.
I think Des Jose was more like, you know, the fingerprints were the... So I think they were the sticky fingerprints, you know...
What was that?
He had some ad going on about Mechanics. The sticky fingerprints that looked like the Boys or something, because the Boys and the fingerprints were the biggest band. So he went with that ad. The most memorable thing about Mechanics was in that punk area, we had like about 100 guys that used to follow us around.
Bother Boys.
Yeah, and they used to stand there and spit on us. Mm. So we're at the White Sands Hotel and there was 300 or 400 people in there. It was quite a movement. And all these guys were standing in front of me pogoing and spitting.
Mm.
And my dad was in the audience and he was like a Geordie, you know. So he said, you can't spit on my son. So he went and headbutted a few
Liverpool
of them on the
kids.
Dance floor.
Yeah. Just give it to him.
And all the cops came and, so.
Because you, at a young age, had, if I remember you back in the day, you were a bit feisty with your attitude. You were an angry little ant, weren't you, really?
Yeah, 100%.
Did you get that from your dad and your mum?
Yeah, probably.
From everyone. Yeah.
Well, you know.
So where did the anger come from? What was that?
Don't know, really. I went to counselling about it, actually, and realised that it did come from my parents.
Oh, really?
Well, I'll tell you a story, right? So when I was young, I used to go into the kitchen as a young 3 or 4 year old, into the kitchen, in the cupboards. We used to open the cupboards and there's vim and whatever
vim.
Chemicals.
I remember that.
Well, you know, whatever chemicals you had under there. So they were worried about me. So my dad went to the fish market and bought a live lobster, stuck a live lobster in the cupboard, knowing that I would go to the cupboard. So I went to the cupboard, opened the cupboard and got confronted with this I thought was a monster. So that's, I think, how I started in my counselling sessions. Become a monster, you'll solve your problems that way. So in the back of my mind, you know, that's pretty deep. But
because I've known you, you know, you always talk about you know, marine sort of things, you know, lobsters, crayfish, starfish, something. Over the years, you've mentioned that a few times, haven't you?
Starfish.
Yeah, well, I mean, all marine life, really. And now these days you live on the riverbank, don't you? Is there a connection? Something
yeah,
like that?
But I'm not a seafood sort of person.
Aren't you? Okay.
No.
All right. And then you go from the mechanics, all right, which is like full on aggro, and the teddy bears. I didn't know you played in the teddy bears.
Well, a guy called John Evans. Johnny. And Sam Marcello was in the mechanics with me. Martin Cropper and Rick Alcorn were the other guys in that band. And he wanted to start the teddy bears, and so we went to the teddy bears and I rehearsed for a month. We were just about to start and I got a phone call from Steve Letch and Phil Ford from Hooker.
They were PJ Hooker. And they'd already been working.
Yeah, with Marcus. I think I took Marcus Sturridge's place and Glenn Patterson was the drummer and they were quite popular. And so it was a Friday night, Windsor Hotel, jam-packed. Was my first gig and jam-packed at the raffles on the Saturday night so we used to get, you know, that built up to about 1200 people. Charles Friday nights and Blazers.
I was a big fan of Hooker. I loved that whole, you were like pre-New Romantic before it happened, a lot of Boomtown Rats, that whole English sound thing, and we all thought they were your own original songs, half those songs.
Yes.
Someone's looking at you and all that. You know? But Steve Letch was a very visual looking guy. Great, good voice, Rob Gill, and you had an unbelievable sound. We always remember you as that smooth dude that had that big box with a million buttons on, and you had fantastic guitar sounds.
Cool.
Oh, maybe I stuffed that bit up the way I said it. No. Are you supposed to say more than just cool?
No.
Hanging?
No, I worked hard to create something different. And because I was working with Australis and I had access to all of these new rack products that were coming out and so on and so forth.
So you had the best gear.
Yeah. And I can remember you coming along and having a look at us and taking a few things away for you.
Well, I did. I always liked Hooker. I thought they were a really good band. And then, of course, you left, as all bands wanted to go over Reese, didn't they?
Yep.
And and then you went and did the Gay Mardi Gras in Sydney. Is that right?
Amongst other things. But I think you got to remember that, I mean, during those days, with the Frames included and all those bands, we made a lot of money. And so what do you do with the money? We put it all in the bank. We'd have 80 grand in the bank, then we'd go over East for 4 weeks and blow it all.
My reference to the Gay Mardi Gras, of course, was because you went with this really cool image, you know, you guys. And then you come back and I go, oh, they're back. And they said you were called Fun World.
That's right.
And you all had makeup on. You look like a bunch of, well, dare I say, an extension from the Gay Mardi Gras parade. And what happened? What was the thought behind that?
We didn't have Alan Simpson as our
directing,
as our sort of boss. So it was a guy called John Adams, and it was his idea. Nicest guy. He's in Queensland now. Beautiful person, and he just had this idea to turn us into a band called Fun World. We needed to move it to the original side because we're in those days it was covers, originals, and we were used to fight about that, but so we wanted to be an original band. So
it was still good. I was impressed with the fact that you changed the image and you had an image and you really believed in what you were doing. You all had these kind of clown outfits and something and makeup. Hopefully there'll be a photo we could just pop up of you with some bit of makeup on. I think your wife Jackie's quite happy with that shot, isn't she?
Yeah, yeah, we'll pop that up. She's not happy. But you know, Steve Letch, for instance, you know, he was just a tyrant, you know, like Raffles Hotel. Mm. She used to do a fire breathing act. Yeah. So that was part of the fun world thing, the clown, the circus, the if you like. And so, you know, he, well, I don't know, about 10 fire engines. He blew the...
Three ceilings later.
Yeah, three ceilings later. Mm. Yeah.
So. Change Alley was a band I used to like. You were in that with Brent Lukanis from The Boys.
Yeah.
What was all that about?
Well, Hooker sort of finished. What am I going to do? Brent had been sacked from The Boys. He was a school friend. Mm. And we used to hang out together anyway. And
The Reynolds brothers were in that?
Yeah.
They were tidy.
Rex, Roger, and Vic.
Yeah, they were good players.
Yeah, they were great players. And we did mainly original music. We played at the Subi, you know, those those sort of places rather than the big places that were, you know, V Capri were playing in, if you like. And so we built up a bit of a crowd following then. Yeah. And then it sort of petered out. It was hard. A guy called Ian Smith was managing us. We lost a lot of money through. I won't mention why, but it was a very difficult time for Ian at that time, and he's passed. God rest his soul.
And he's gone. Yeah.
But yeah, we lost a lot of money, and I believe a few other bands did as well. And so yeah, I was sort of on the bones of my butt. What am I going to do? Brent and I decided let's go to Sydney. Mm. We're writing good songs. We went to Sydney and caught up with a guy called John Hemans, who played with Mark Lazotte in what was the band called? I can't remember.
Injectors.
No. It's on the tip of my tongue.
Not the kind. That was
a bit of a pun.
Yeah, very nice.
And Peter Lizowich, a guy called Peter Lizowich, and Warwick Fraser, who was Stuart Fraser from
Noiseworks.
Noiseworks' brother. Mm. And we formed a band called Never Ending. And we actually started packing places out at the Piccadilly. And
Gudinski comes and checks you out?
Gudinski comes and checks us out and a few record companies. Rob Galley was in the band as well. Mm. We flew him over. He was in Hooker, Rob. Mm-hmm. With Phil and Sam, obviously, in those days. And, we had a few people chasing us, and there was a lot of drugs going around in those days, and a lot of bad drugs, and a couple of the guys got into those sort of drugs, and,
fell apart.
Yeah, fell apart.
So you come back from there, and then you take up in a trio with Rob Watson and who else?
Tony Woodward, he was Spiny Norman, and he was from Wyala as well, so is Rob. Formed a three-piece band. I think John Pym was playing, he left, I joined. We played seven nights a week at the casino, and the eighth gig was at the Sandringham on the Sunday session, so we did eight gigs a week. So I did that for a couple of years, and that was a good experience to play with those guys, and that led into meeting Carl Pink and Tim Count. They were doing, I think, Count Me In or something like that. I can't remember what the band's name was. I joined The Kind. Boyd Wilson was in The Kind, and we had an original thing going with Denise DeMarchi and stuff then. Mm-hmm. Interviewed Denise earlier on, obviously, and she filled us in on that. But yeah, so that, you know, The Kind, and then we got the call from Paul Redman, Michael Parks, and Barry Lytton at the time.
But you got another phone call before that. There was I think I remember when Des Jose gave you a phone call and tried to get you to join our V Capri, because we were after a guitar player at the time, because I think Damien or Clint couldn't do it for whatever reason. And I said, get Gary Dunn, that guy's unbelievable. Tried to get the Dunny, and he knocked his back.
Well, that's because I said to Des, okay, I'll do it, but you put $52,000 in a bank account. That's $1,000 a week for the next year, right?
Yeah.
And I won't take the $52,000 straight away. I'll take $1,000 a week. And he laughed at me and said, see you later.
Yeah.
So that was that. So.
Right.
I needed some stability. So
Yeah.
I didn't realise how good you guys were at that time either, Al. So, you know.
Goes on. So the kind, you did that.
Yep.
And then after the kind, you keep some of the people in there and you form the Night After. Right? Yep. Now, the Night After was a very good band. I think it's where every muso used to finish their gig. And I know you like to think that we went up there to watch the band, but really, if we hadn't picked up by 12 o'clock,
that's exactly
we'd go
right.
Gobbles to try yeah, and get
all the desperados. I saw you.
That's right. I hardly ever went there, of course. You know, but the Night After was a fantastic band, a very versatile. And from what I remember, you were probably the main person that kept it all together. Is that would that be true?
Yeah.
And who was in the Night After? Give me some of the names.
Well, Redmond Parks and Litton. Was their band, and they all decided to leave. Redmond went to do Gary Shannon, Morning Crew. Mm-hmm. Michael Parks went and did Floors or something, and Barry Litton went and did Real Estate.
Yeah.
And so, the opportunity was there. I took over and got a few other people in the band, and that lasted 9 years.
Yeah.
It was great because John Anderson, Bob Maher, gave us the opportunity by going to the entertainment centre and giving all the roadies drink cards, that all the big bands would come over. So they used to play with us. Eurythmics, Simply Red,
fantastic people.
Charlie Sexton,
whoever. Tiny Tim.
Yeah, Tiny Tim. Anyway, a bit wafty, but we did Tiptoe for the Chillers for 30 minutes, can you believe? But it was that sort of place. It was, you know, the Eagles were there. Chris Mainwaring was a really good friend of mine. And lots of different people just seemed to be
a lot of celebrities
vibe.
Went up there. Yeah, didn't they? It was a place to be seen.
Yeah, and it was a bit of a vibe there. And
how long did you do that for?
9 years.
Long time.
Yeah,
had to be good.
Yep. So that was from about 86 to 95.
How many free drinks you would have had over 9 years? How many gallons would you have drank up at that place?
I'm lucky I'm still alive, I reckon.
And Loreen and Steph, fantastic girls in the band.
Yeah, well, there's Loreen Adams or whatever you want, a few different names. Stephanie Tornatora, Stephanie's daughter Carly, who was this big when I met her, just had her first child, beautiful woman. Yeah. But we used to bring all our kids up there as well, like Carl Pink, absolute legend, great singer, bass player, keyboard player, Finney Correa, who's, you know, running the Whopper thing now, you know, Tim Count, as you know, brilliant keyboard player, Jimmy Smith on sax.
Very versatile, that you guys could do anything.
Yeah, Al Lyford on bass guitar, Al with Manteca, and just unbelievable singer, bass player. And so the band was rock solid and great. It was fantastic.
You did 9 years with the Night After up at Gobbles, and you were saying you played with a lot of, we might say famous people, as you said, Tiny Tim and lots of other people from the Entertainment Centre. And, you know, my humble opinion, there'd be no one greater that got up on stage with you than one James Morley. Now, James being the superstar that he is, you saw the obvious talent in that guy and decided to get a band together with him called Our Generation.
Mm.
Talk to me about that.
Well, I saw James first on one of those Monday Herdsmen things, you know, those
Monday,
you know, long weekend, Strawberry Blonde.
Oh.
And he used to come up to Gobbles and stand on the side of the stage and
drawing.
Yeah, with, and because I gave him so many drink chips, he'd have all these shooters. So all the band, you know. And James is a fantastic person. He used to get up and sing with us, and he's a great singer, great bass player, great
rounder.
And So, we formed a band called Our Generation. And the interesting thing about Our Generation, if you like, was it was formed in 1998. And we were the first band, a corporate band, to dress up and to have a 60s, a 70s, and an 80s, and a 90s.
Not like tribute type thing, is it?
Yes. And we were dress up tribute. And I know you don't like tributes.
Fake,
but
fake wigs and all
Dean
that.
Dean Clares, we got Dean Clares to do our intros and all that sort of stuff. And yeah, we lived those, the sensational 60s, the hip 70s, the retro 80s, whatever the 90s was, I can't remember.
But you got dressed up in?
Absolutely, 100%. Did you? And we did that for from 1998 to 2000. 13, I think it was, corporate bands. But what we brought to the genre as well, if you like, or to the corporate scene, was we added a three-piece brass section and called it Swing Generation.
Oh.
So we had a swing band with Marty Pervin and some other people from Whopper would join us, and we'd do the Swing Generation thing. So we'd do all the crooning stuff in the first set. And then, and I think there was a few people in town that are well known that saw that, that went, oh, that's a good idea.
Who?
Oh, I can't mention their names.
You can.
Well, nice. Todd Johnson and Jeremy McCanty. But
Hot Toddy?
Yes. But, you know.
What, ripped you off?
That, no, I'm not saying they ripped us off. You're saying that.
Oh.
But what I'm saying is, we sort of led the way in costumes and that corporate scene. That's where it all started.
Blame you for what's happened.
Yes, you must. And, you know, I'm very proud of that, to be honest with you, because, you know, James Morley, you know, Rocco Mazzoni, there was Monique Robinson, who's called O'Sullivan now, and Di, and, Nigel Shelburne on bass. I'm trying to remember everyone.
You guys did a lot of corporate work.
Yeah.
I mean, you're a very professional band.
We're doing three corporate gigs a week. We did Lewin 10 years in a row.
Yeah.
So three corporate gigs a week, that's 150 gigs. I mean, these days you're lucky if you do six in a year.
Yeah.
You know, so it was pretty...
You're still in contact with Jamesy boy? You lost a bit of contact there for a while.
Yeah, James and I are fantastic friends always.
Yeah.
And
close.
He's going to actually, to be honest with you, we just did that disco Inferno thing, and Bob Brisbane can't make one of the nights, and James is going to fill in. And yeah, we just did an Our Generation reunion at the Civic Hotel.
I saw that.
You know, I mean, we did it as a bit of a just thing to get together and, and just say hello to each other.
He's a hard worker, old James.
250 people.
I see him on Facebook. Oh, he's everywhere, that guy.
He's a wonderful guy. Yeah. And, you know, he's with Amanda now. And
likes a frothy.
And I'm glad Amanda, I think, has levelled him out a bit. And
really?
Yeah. And, he's happy and good, you know.
You're very much a family man these days.
Yep.
Is that where you met your lovely wife, Jackie?
I've always been a family man. I've always had really high morals. I've been married to my wife, Jackie, God bless her, for over 30 years now. And
you to me, are like a Hollywood couple. She's a glamour. And to a degree, when you get dolled up with your suit on, you're a bit of a glamour, a bit of a Hollywood couple. And I used to... suited for like soulmates, that you look very much at peace for 30 years together. Would it be true to say that she was probably the one that calmed you down and got you to where you are today?
No doubt. Yeah. If I'd have met Jackie, I'd probably be dead. I probably would have died of a drug overdose, to be honest with you, or something like that. So,
really?
Absolutely. Yeah. I was heading to nowhere.
You wouldn't have gotten the teddy bears?
No, that was. After, you know, living in Sydney, cocaine city, all sorts of things were going on. I don't have any problem with owning the fact that if it wasn't for meeting Jackie and
she's a great girl.
Yeah.
She's a good girl. She's a stunner. Yeah, there's no doubt. She still looks good today. I saw her the other night, you know, she was strutting her stuff.
No, I'm very proud of her. I'm proud of my family.
You got two good girls.
Yeah. My daughters, grandkids. Jessica and Bridget, and four grandkids, Bam, Drake,
ten
Knox.
Dogs, six grandkids. Every time I ring you up, it's like the racket on the phone.
And Finn's just my beautiful little granddaughter. And yeah, so life now is having gone through all the trials and tribulations of life, as you do. And look, I mean, you know, I've known you for quite a long time. Mm. You've been married a few times. Everyone's been married a few times. Everyone
could be married a few times in the future.
You know, and not that I'm judging by anything like that, but yeah, I mean, Jackie and I have stuck by each other and become a team. And yeah, it's just a wonderful feeling to have someone that is behind you and loves you so much. And
true love travels down a rocky road, you know.
Yeah.
And it gets rough sometimes.
Yeah.
And you're able to talk it out and see it through. Anyway.
I think marriage is the hardest thing you'll ever do in your life.
Jesus Christ.
You know, mate, without a doubt. So,
apart now from moving sideways,
jump, apart from playing the lead, break and jump.
Moving sideways is that part of the? Let me get back over here. What was the last album that you bought? Well, do you buy albums anymore, or do you?
No, I don't buy albums anymore. It was probably John Mayer. Album actually,
And
I get given a lot of albums now.
Yeah,
I listen to them. Yeah,
the you're a very good guitar player. You're very, I think, underrated in town. But you know, a lot of people sort of know you as a go-to sort of guitar player for your sound and your ability to be able to pull it off every time. Who was your earliest influence?
Without a doubt, George Harrison.
George.
And then as a teenager, I discovered Dave Gilmour and Eric Clapton.
Yeah.
So they're probably my top three. And then later on, Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Mm-hmm.
So top four.
Yeah. Very good. Other jobs you've had through your life. Now, I know you worked at Cosmic.
Yep. So
you were pretty well in charge at Cosmic for a while, weren't you? You were Johnny's right-hand man.
No, I was always part-time. I was the prankster, and I was always the top salesperson. But, you know, that's wherever I go. Look, always had a day job from, Cosmic. I worked at Australis, a wholesale company called CMI. So I did WA, South Australia, Northern Territory. Did that for 13 years, up until 2013. So this is apart from the music. Then I had a startup company called Open Live, and the vibe from that was to, it was a friend of mine created a recording facility where you could record live. It would go up into the cloud, get mixed, and then people could buy it the next day. So if you went to see a Pink Floyd live concert, you could buy for $20, let's say, the recording of the night, the live recording, which would then go up into the cloud, get mixed and be available the next day. It was also a bit of a copyright thing where for APRA in Australia, but for overseas, where they would put these boxes called a master builder in each venue, and that would record bands playing music, so the companies could then get their
percentage. So what happened to all that? They're just...
Well, I joined it. I raised $1.6 million in seed funding around Australia, and there were seven directors in the company, and we were just about to do a big deal with YouTube, $20 million US. Mm. We came back from trips because we went to London, New York, LA for a year. Came back to a board meeting and they sacked us. The other five members of the board sacked us too, just before we were about to make it. And so that company is still open, but nothing's happened for 4 years since we went. So
I can remember you and I not only went to work in Bones together, but I think we shared the same bank at Warwick. We used to go to the ANZ Bank of Warwick. And I can remember standing there in the queue.
I said New World Health and Fitness.
And I can remember seeing you, and you were buffed. Yes. You were about twice the size you were. I don't know if you're on the juice or what, mate, but you were like out here, all right? Mm. And you, so you did the health and fitness thing for a while.
Yeah.
What got you into that?
Yeah, so that was in between, I forgot to mention that to you before, but yeah, that was 2002-ish.
Mm-hmm.
I went in partnership with Paul Middleton.
Yep.
I was a soccer player as well, so I didn't talk about that, but I played for Bayswater in Perth, and I played national, or state soccer, Queensland, South Australia and WA, and the fitness club.
Over your 100 interviews that you've done, we've done some pretty famous people in Perth. But you also made contact with one Michael Jackson, Wacko. Now, what happened there?
2006, I think. Yeah, 2006, Michael Jackson had his tour. My wife, he was staying at Observation City. My wife went, took the kids. Jessica was 10, Bridget was 6.
You were living in Bayswater then?
We were living in Doubleview. Yeah. And she took them down It was a ridiculous time, 1 o'clock in the morning or whatever. There was 5,000 people out the front. He came walking out, and my wife went up to one of the bouncers and said, or one of the security guys, and said, "Look, Mike, we're so far at the back." She was there late. "Do you mind if my kids just sort of stand here? I'll keep my eye on them, and they're in front of you." And the guy said, "Yep, no problem." Michael Jackson came walking out, saw my daughter Jessica, and grabbed her by the hand, pulled her into his little group, if you like, and so they were looking, who's the parents, where are the parents? And so next minute Jackie was upstairs on the 30th floor in the penthouse with Jessica and
Bridget. So you weren't
there? Bridget. No, I wasn't there. And so they came home and told me about all that. And so, yeah, I'm going, yeah, okay, no worries. Mm-hmm. And then 5 o'clock that day, Jessica came home from school. Phone rings, because we didn't have mobile phones, so we're on the wall. So I say, yes, hello. And he goes, "Hey, it's Michael Jackson.
Hello.
Is Jessica there?" And I said, seriously? And he said, "Yeah, I want to talk to Jessica." So I suddenly gathered, wow, this was true. So I ran out. I said, "Hang on, Michael. She's over the Oval." The Oval was across the road. So I ran outside and said, "Jessica, Michael Jackson."
How old was Jessica then?
She was 10. And so, 100 kids come back to our place while she was talking to Michael on the phone. So she put him back on the phone to me, and he just said, "Can you come and hang out with us for 3 days? And we hung out with him for 3 days. We went to the concert with Dan and Val Denton, mm-hmm. Holly
I'm sure he's going to kill you.
He's going to kill me. Ashley, we're also there. Yeah. So, and obviously Holly calls herself Holly Wally.
Well, she used to.
Michael Jackson or whatever.
Lately.
But yeah, so.
Did you have any suspicions back then of how he was? In hindsight now, we hear all these weird stories about Netherland or whatever. Did he appear weird to you?
It's definitely weird. I mean, we went into his bedroom and tried on his clothes. Jackie tried on his clothes. He said, "Hey, why don't you put my hat and my jacket on and stick your head over the balcony?" Because there was 1,000 people just hanging out down the bottom of, you look down and you go, whoa. And so Jackie stuck her head over and they all thought it was Michael. Screamed. They all went nuts. I wrote a song with him and played piano in his hotel room.
Was that on Thriller?
No. I mean, it's on some film because there was four guys constantly filming.
Yep.
So they've got it on film somewhere.
Were they the federal police?
No, honestly, he was a gentleman. He was a nice guy.
Yep.
He was weird, had the thing at that time. He obviously changed his colour and all that sort of stuff. And
it was different.
You look at the documentaries now that I saw 6 months ago or whatever, and certainly you wonder,
if you weren't there. Everything. A bit like me with Gary Glitter.
Yeah.
He was winking at me and Mum picked me up. And what could have happened,
But, I didn't see anything bad or anything. We got asked to do, we got offered $10,000 to do a page in the Sunday Times to do an interview, but we declined because...
What?
Didn't really think it was the right thing to do. I'm a moral person, so...
Moving even further sideways. I'm going out on a limb now, all right?
Don't you do anything horrible to me.
I won't.
Okay.
All right. You have interviewed, 99 people, and who is the hardest one to interview out of all the people we interviewed? Remember, you'll probably see this person in the pub coming up in the future at some point. So is there any one of them has been just hard to get the information out of, or were they just under your spell at all times?
No, I can't answer that question.
Oh, jeez. Fence it up. Like John Starr. Like a magpie on the fence, mate.
You'll kill me for that.
Well, who was the best to interview? Who was the absolute cracker?
I don't think I should answer that question either, because they're all... Everyone's got their own story. So.
Their own style, I think.
No, they've just got their own story. And my job is, you told me beginning, and I do everything you say. Is to extract their story and sit and not be judgmental in any way whatsoever. So yeah, I can give you names of who I like and I don't like, and they could probably give you names of whether they liked it or didn't like it, but I don't think that's. I don't think this is a forum to discuss.
Is it true that when you go to a shopping centre and you bump into a muso, they start telling you their life story now?
Yes.
Especially if they haven't done the interview.
Yeah.
Hi, Gary. I was born in such and such. You go, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Where's the Vegemite? Yeah. Why did you decide to do that thing when you got that golden phone call from me and I wanted someone to be a compere? You'd never done it before. So why, when you'd never done anything like before, you're out of your comfort zone, all right, why did you decide to be the compere?
Well, there was a time in my life where my mum had just passed away. I nursed her to death, and my dog just died, and I was always a very selfish person, I think, and what an opportunity you gave me to give something back and to do something without wanting money or wanting anything.
There was no money.
No.
There's still no money.
Honestly not. It's amazing I'm still alive and still surviving. But no, just I felt that this was the time for my calling to help, if you like.
Do you feel that I'm grooming you to be the next Lord Mayor of Perth? Do you ever feel as if the suit, the tie, the heavy scrutiny that you have to go under, that I think that maybe you might have a political future? Because you look a bit like a political figure. Do you think you would ever go down that path of being politics?
Well, I reckon, you know how the politicians now in federal politics have the stuff coming up about the, you know, whether they're actually a citizen, and they bring up every bit of dirt. The dirt.
Do you reckon there's too much behind you?
It'd be way too much for me to get even.
You reckon it's just gone?
Yeah. Someone would bring something up, I reckon. Mm. What do you think, Mark? You're not saying anything.
All right, so, okay, let's move it back in a bit. I've gone out left, right. Okay, what are we up to? One of my favourite ones. Great questions, these two. Favourite band of all time?
I have to say the Beatles. I know that everyone says it, but I just have to say that because...
You're stranded on a deserted island.
Who thought of these questions? This is a ridiculous question.
It's not a ridiculous question at all. What it does is it exposes you under a time when you're going to be on your own and vulnerable. What album would you take that would reflect your life? That's what it's about. So
you know what
album would you take?
I'm going to answer this question really quickly. Oh. And I'm going to say one, because everyone I interview on the show just muddles around with it and has so many different things. Dark Side of the Moon, no question.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah. Any particular reason? What does that album? What does that album do to you?
It takes you. Well, the rain is falling. Yeah. It takes you from anger to placid to dreamy to, it's just got so many emotions. I don't think I've heard an album with so many emotions in it.
Favorite TV show growing up?
I didn't think about this one, but and I've asked it enough times.
Do not say Coronation Street, all right?
But I'd have to say Countdown.
Countdown?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I must agree. Yeah. Countdown was definitely, we all watched it religiously, and it was always something different.
And if I really, really close, because I was going to say this, The Winners.
The Winners?
Yeah, Sunday night with Drew Morfitt, footy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm a sports fanatic.
Oh, yeah.
Like anything at all.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
You're going to ask me a question later about something you don't know about me, or
I'll get to that.
Oh, okay.
What does the future hold for you, apart from the Lord Mayor, the Winners project? What do you want to do?
Well, the future for me is to help as many people as I possibly can.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of people with depression. There's a lot of people with no money. And I'm not one of them with lots of money or anything like that. But just to help people in any way I can, to become a better person.
How do you think that this program has helped the music industry?
Well, I think it's, everyone's got different opinions. You know, I think it's amalgamated a lot of people that, you know, like we talked about before, that, you know, we all used to go, oh, you know, they're fucked and this and that. And, you know, anyone who was pulling the
image,
most crowds.
Yeah, ego, yeah.
Yeah. But really, at the end of the day, it was just a bravado thing. And I think that for everyone to come together, because look, you know, people like, and, you know, don't take anything out of this, people like Dean Denton, you know, and, you know, he was obviously struggling, and, you know, and lots of other people I know that are struggling, you know, Donna Green with MS and
Steve Essex.
Yeah, Steve Essex. And
we've lost a few along the way, yeah.
People who we've interviewed, like Pecco.
Yep.
You know, I think it really brings home to you. It just brings home to you that, you know.
You're not getting misty-eyed on me, are you?
Yeah. Yeah, because.
God. Now, that's something you've never been able to do, all right? Don't take holidays, champ, all right? I've got you. I think you've done a great job under hard conditions, because I just chuck you in here and say, just ask these questions and that. But you've got a very good way of getting to people and freeing them up to be able to talk. Do you collect anything?
Yeah, I collect memories.
Yeah.
You know, that's about it for me. And I'm a sporting buff, so I can tell you anything you like about any cricket game or football game or who won championships.
Yeah, I know you've done that a couple of times on interviews, and I go, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah.
Because you do, you say, oh, that was like 1977 Ashes tour or something. Yeah. How the hell does he know that shit? But did I ask you the question, unfulfilled ambitions? Did I ask that? I don't think I did.
No, you didn't.
Okay. What unfulfilled ambitions do you have? Don't mind a little drop myself there, mate.
I don't really have any, to be honest with you. I'm pretty happy.
Yep.
You know, I've got a great family. I've got a great bunch of friends. You know, I'm a homebody. I work so much. I like, when I get home, I like to be at home. Love my wife and my family. And just to be happy. Mm-hmm. If anything, if I can be as happy as I have been, I'll be really grateful for that.
Yeah. Music industry today, you've been in the industry for a long, long time. What do you think?
It's tough.
Yeah, where's it gone wrong?
I don't know whether it's gone wrong. I think maybe technology
end up with it as a trickle.
Technology's, you know, it's really stuffed our industry as far as people, you know, going to see a live band. I mean, I play now and people love it, you know, in that moment, like they always have.
Mm.
But to get them out of their house and into that venue is a lot more difficult nowadays than it ever has been.
More distractions now.
Yeah.
You know, you've got to be really good or something very exclusive.
Mm. But I go and see things like, the Mount Henry Tavern with Brendan Fosdyke and Kelly Green and all that. And that just about makes me cry. Yep. I get very emotional.
Takes you back to where we started.
Yeah. Yep. It's a great night, but look how many people are there, you know. You and I try lots of different things to try and get people out.
Mm.
You know, and the people that come there enjoy it.
Yep.
But not a lot of people come.
80s pub band legends, we've done that a few times.
Yeah. We're coming up for our fifth...
number five, yeah.
July the 13th.
You run that like clockwork?
The Charles Hotel. Come and see it. It's a great show.
It is a great show.
A great bunch of musicians who get together and perform, give it their utmost, and they enjoy it.
So. Diane Count, you're in a duo with her?
Yeah, Diane Watkins now.
Oh, sorry.
Beautiful person. She married after Tim... A guy called Ben Watkins, beautiful guy. Duo with her, and we play Casino, we play all over the sort of place, but it's not the same as a band and for both of us.
Your new adventure is disco. What's going on there?
Disco Inferno, something you sort of came up with as usual. Am I allowed to say that or not?
What?
Is Lance going to get pissed off?
Though? Oh, Lance always gets pissed off. That's cool.
Yeah, we did our first gig a couple of weeks ago and it was great. We had like 300 people there. We thought we'd get more, but the vibe was great. We're going to build on it. We're playing the first Friday of every month at the Charles Hotel.
It's great. Great players.
Bob Brisbane, Nando and all on sax, and Craig Skelton on keyboards, Kim Siragusa, Stuart Robertson on drums, Mama Cass, Karina Cass on bass. Yeah.
It's a great band.
Yeah. They're great musicians, but they're just like me. They're looking for something. They're trying to do something, and the amount of work and rehearsal that goes into to putting on a show like this for the amount of money you get, well, it's not even worth thinking about the money. And that's the way our industry has become. It's like it's a passion. Yeah. It's something we enjoy, and we do it. I know Mark here, works his nuts off. And always has, and supports the music industry. He always has. He is such a legend, and the amount of return he gets, and the amount of pain, and the ass phone calls he probably gets from all sorts of people that he owes money to. It's just not right. The guy is a legend trying to do his own, trying to do something for our industry.
Without him,
no.
And Strawny, of course, over there.
Yeah.
Now I had something I was going to say to you. Music. When we first picked up the guitar or drums or whatever, I don't think the thought ever went through our mind about how much money we're going to make.
No.
It was always about this is going to be fun.
But technology has come along.
But if everyone treats it as fun, success will follow.
Yeah.
Because anything that's good will succeed. Yeah. If you're crappy, if you're only doing it to make a quick corporate buck, then it's short-lived.
Well, it's never been like that. And
there's nothing better than seeing you pissed on stage with a couple of scotches in your hand and you just let rip, because you're still a good performer, and you put on good quality shows. I think we're just about done. I know you're done. The GoFundMe page.
Yeah.
Hasn't been a huge success up until now. We got, what would your message be? I think I might say something when you interview me down the track about that, but it's okay if we're enjoying the show. There's lots and lots of people, thousands upon thousands of people have watched these shows. And yet, when it comes to putting their hand in the pocket, they haven't probably done enough.
Well, I don't know whether you can judge people on that. And what do I say? It's like
politician.
I gave $100 to Steve Essex's thing.
It's tough. We did. There's not a lot of money left around. I can see shops closing up all the time.
Yeah. Everyone goes and buys a coffee every day probably for $5. That's $35 a week. I don't know.
Yeah.
If you can give a dollar to GoFundMe. We've tried raising money in many ways. We raised 17 grand for Peco.
Yeah.
We did the way we were at Mandurah.
Yeah. We're doing something for Steve coming up. Are you organising something for Steve Essex, aren't we?
Yes, Steve Essex. Well, I think we haven't got a date yet. We're trying to work that out, but we're going to do a benefit concert for Steve.
What about another Gobbles reunion? Is that going to be on the cards?
Yeah, Gobbles reunion's coming up again. Obviously you have to fly people in. So it's really difficult because you have to make ends meet, And you're flying, airfares and we do it for nothing.
Yeah.
And we enjoy it, obviously. And we enjoy seeing people. And that's our job, is to get people excited and have a good time.
Then my final question. Yeah. It was two. One is, what would you put on your gravestone?
One, I've asked that question 100 times. Or 99,
yeah.
And I think would be just enjoy it.
What, being dead?
You only get one chance.
Oh.
Life.
Yeah.
Just enjoy it.
Yeah.
You only get one chance.
Now, is there anything that I haven't asked you, because you're the compere, and I'm just the novice that came in for the night.
You've done a great job.
Had a crack, buddy, that's all you can do. anything I forgot to ask you? Or is there anything that we don't know about you or anyone you haven't mentioned that you should have mentioned?
Oh,
think, come on.
There's 100 people.
Yeah.
You know, as you know, I sit there and ask people the same question and think, you know, come on. You know, just tell me who it is. So I'm in that position now, in this chair, and yeah, there's probably quite a few people I've forgotten, and I apologise for that.
The good thing about this little studio is you don't realise the cameras are on. It's like there's Mark and there's Phil, there's you and
it's a conversation, isn't
That's what it is, you know. So, Gary Dunn, thank you very much.
But
that's it, you're done.
No, no, but can I go on for a second?
Jeez, come on then, off you go. I'm over it.
I want to acknowledge you.
Let's go.
No. And I want to acknowledge this guy here, Mark.
Yeah.
And this guy here, Strawny. Mr. Phil Strawn, who gives his utmost at all times. And thank you, Phil, for your input. I mean, you know, he's come from South Australia. He doesn't know all the musos from Perth or anything like that. He certainly got to know them, but but you know, he's done it for nothing. You know, we've got a guy called Aaron Devenish now who does a lot of the editing. Aaron, you know, thank you so much for everything you do. We're not giving him 1 cent because we don't have 1 cent.
That's right.
But I just think that, you know, it's a great thing what we're doing. And
there's no doubt the music industry, you know, the older established ones that are still out there working or, you know, put the hard yards in, I know there's a lot more camaraderie around today because I think they all lost contact as they got older. And I think having a show like this does bring everyone back into the field. They can all watch and learn something about someone they didn't know. A lot of people have struggled over the last couple of years, and that exposes that a little bit where people can help. And I know there's been situations where we have helped, like with Petco and all that. So, you know, you've done a good job doing that.
Yeah.
Good producer of the show too, I think. Now, mate, I know you're done. Get out of here. Thanks for coming.
I've got the producer going, you know, wind it up. So, you know, what's the problem here? So
it's time to get out of here.
No worries. Look, thanks so much.
Gaz, good on you, mate.
Thanks very much.
Thanks for episode 100 with the compere, Mr. Gary Dunn.
You're supposed to say, so what clip have we got coming?
Oh, yes. Do we have a clip?
I believe it's something from Hooker, 1989 reunion.
We don't have another reunion coming up. Wouldn't see it.
I don't know whether we can find Steve Lesh. Last time I heard he had purple hair and no teeth in Scarborough.
We'll write that one off. Okay, yeah. So this is the end of the profile for this week. Thanks for viewing. Don't forget to subscribe. Put your thumbs up for that. We need to get to 300. Is that right, Mark? Have we made it yet?
We're over 300.
Oh, my God. We're on a roll. We're up to 300.
302 subscribers.
Next stop, 1,000.
Okay.
So next interview, you do me. Is that right?
Has he done me already? I do you. Are you going to be in a compromising position or not?
Mate, let's just keep it above board.
Right? Okay.
So,
no worries.
Thanks for viewing. See you next time.
Thank you. Oh!
ProCopy, we can transfer audio to CD, make CD, DVD and Blu-ray copies, transfer video to DVD, Blu-ray or HD, digitise slides and photos, and supply custom USBs. You can see more details at procopy.com.au or call us on 08 9375 3902 for more information.